Okay.
Hello, hello, and welcome to another wonderful episode of Submitted for Your Approval, the weekly card review show for Collective, the community-created card game, where you create the cards. I am joined today by my faithful co-host, Grief.
Howdy, folks.
And Empty Folder had a thing, and he told me what the thing was, and I totally forgot, but we have in his place a common face here to see around as Submitted for Your Approval. Might as well be our fourth panelist. Wujek Marion, say hi.
Say hi.
Awesome. Okay, we're going to jump straight into it with the accepted submissions. These cards are already in the game, and there's nothing you can do about that unless you want to submit an update. Let's talk about the first thing you should probably maybe submit an update for, the Evolution Stone, which is a one-drop neutral action from nowhere in particular with target unit shifts one within its affinity and ready it. So I'm confused. I know this was actually a mistake on Zinker's part.
Yeah.
But was it also a mistake on the entire community's part, not remembering what we learned from reoccurring accident? This thing just says target unit shifts one, as in it doesn't specify ally or enemy. This is just like reoccurring accident 2.0. Grief, what do you think of this card?
It's cool. It's one mana hard removal for most cases. And even when they get something out of it, well, it probably doesn't have to, in most cases, doesn't even share the synergies that you actually want to build around. In decks that care about it, yeah, you can shift your own stuff, but why would you? You just, for one mana, remove the biggest threat on the board. Sure, you get one, maybe just get one bigger dude, but in most cases, these kinds of units live from summons and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Wujek, what do you think of this?
Okay. Oh, gosh. So, let me first say, the only positive thing I've got to say about this targeting enemy units. I do appreciate that when this does target enemy units, it does reward your knowledge of the card pool and what the unit can shift into and at which costs there even are units in an affinity. Okay, now that's out of the way. This card is fucking bullshit. It's quite frankly just stronger reoccurring accidents, how I see it.
Yeah.
It's just way more versatile. It's way stronger. It often can just be a one mana banish a unit. And even if it isn't, I mean, damn, shifting a karma into a 2-drop is or one mana, yeah, that sure ain't too bad.
Yeah, so
and yeah, I think like the main strength of it is also that like even in a matchup where this is not great, which those matchups exist against something like aggro Helden, you probably don't want to shift their own units. Just shifting your stuff is really fucking good with this. It's just so value.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
the card is just too versatile. This just cannot target enemies, as I see it.
Yeah, I'm curious to see how it'll happen. I do know it was actually a mistake on Zinker's part, so we'll see. The Presenter is a one-drop mind dream. Mind dream human from Zuriel with Ambush and Entrance, replace two cards in hand, replace a card in hand with two Wonder Spheres. Wonder Sphere is a 1/1 Figment artifact with Ambush in its mind. So, a couple notes upon this. This is a new realm that Magneter's attempting. This is his fifth attempt, his third success. And the whole idea is it's a dream zoo. We've already had quite a few things that have been either dream or dream adjacent, if you include things that like Hallucinogenica, which is sort of like a just a living like weirdness type thing. I do want to congratulate Magneter on a couple things. I do feel that the realm was maybe a little bit rushed out, but I do like the aesthetic, the whole like primary colors forward, weird shapes, kind of mishmash stuff that he's been playing around with and he's been showing around in art sharing. I don't like it on like a lore development point, but I do like it on an aesthetic point. And this whole idea with these figments is supposed to be that you create these figments in order to like banish them for effects later. And that's going to be a development that we'll see kind of pop out of this, but currently this is what we got. Grief, what do you think of this?
It's a fine card. Nothing to write home about. Ghost card advantage neutral. You just discard anything and you get two ambushes into your hand. It's good enough for whatever deck you want to run it. Will it see very much competitive play or whatever? Yeah, probably not. But it's fine. Also, this dude has two left hands.
I love it. That is interesting.
Let's say that was intended.
Zuriel!
To be honest, I'm absolutely sure it was intended.
It's super flavorful, so yeah. Wuyak, what do you think of this?
It's shit until it gets support.
Yeah.
As of right now, this is just outclassed by like 90% of Mind 1 drops, and Mind has a lot of 1 drops, and there is quite frankly just no reason to run it in any deck. If it gets support, yeah, it will probably be pretty good. I mean, depending on how good said support is, of course.
Yeah, that's another thing to be said for Magneter, is that he did the impossible and got the support card in before the generally applicable card, right? More power to him.
This card kind of needs to exist for the Figment payoffs to exist, let's be honest, because we have no units with a Figment tribe in game yet.
Yes, this does actually play into one existing idea, and that is the non-native one-cost stuff, because this is both a one-drop unit, and it gives you non-native one-cost units. Are they good? No, but it's a good way to get just reliable non-natives in early on, so maybe it could work out, especially with big boy.
You can, but as a counterpoint, at that point, wouldn't you rather run the 1/2 that just gets you a prototype every turn?
Damn. Well, that requires you deal damage, right?
Yeah. Still, I don't know.
Whereas this is just guaranteed. So, you know,
the thing is that this also removes a card from your hand, which is pretty notable.
Yeah. Well, with that deck, depending on how you're running it, you might actually have the fodder to spare. But yeah, also, let's move on.
You can mass production, another option.
Yeah. Crawl the Mastermind is a 6-drop mind exclusive 5/4 psychic aberration from Verstalt. With ward, unblockable, and summon and start a turn, Surmise, if the next card your opponent plays this turn is marked, counter it. Surmise places a hidden mark on a chosen card in your opponent's hand. So this is a big self-contained engine for the Surmise mark archetype. You can get a reliable source of marking, and you can play some really, really good mind games for your opponent if you can get this in at 6. Also, the flavor and the art reference, that's something I just gotta point out, and I gotta applaud. This is, and it's actually very, very forward about what it's referencing without going into the potential issues territory, which I really, really enjoy that. Wuyak, what do you think of this?
I mean, it's just fun. It's just a very fun control card. My only worry is that 6 mana for a unit that doesn't impact the board in any way the turn it has play is a bit rough. That's like generally around the mana cost where playing those sorts of units gets a bit sketchy. But I mean, the payoff is really good if it does hit.
Yeah.
Especially if this hits the board on initiative, which it very well may. It may even hit board on initiative around turn 4. Very easily with some Attune shenanigans, maybe a cat here and there, maybe some Barnacle Brothers. It's just a very fun control card.
Grief, what do you think of this?
Well, time to build marked matters on my main account. I actually like this card a lot. I just now noticed, even though I looked at the card multiple times, that it is exclusive because I actually want to play marked KM. Fuck, I cannot do that anymore.
Shit. That was intended, actually. I was there.
Yeah. I don't really want to pay more mana for the auto-marked cards because at higher cost, they're very, very questionable when it comes to their use case.
That's kind of the point, actually.
Sorry, what?
That's kind of part of the point.
Yeah, the thing is, at that point, the best use case for this deck would be marked matters, but marked matters cards are all over the place in terms of affinities, and Surmise is a shit mechanic that I don't care about because most cards that users don't really aren't really good.
Yeah, I like it. Anyways, I wanna hop over to the accepted submissions, which is
I'll put it this way, Grief. Keep in mind. Essence Shifter is a card that exists.
Ha, in mind. Okay. Okay, so these cards are the active submissions. Don't worry, don't freak out. These cards are not in the game yet, but they could be, depending on how you vote. Starting with the Primed Bomb is a 3-drop neutral 0/5 explosive device. With Cant's attack and Awaken 5, deal 10 damage to each player and destroy all units. This is from Troy, who is a new player, and we just wanted to feature his card for the most part.
Wait a second. Did you look at the person who posted the card?
Oh, did someone else post it this time?
This could be another post by Popka, because Troy was already on your card where Taza got a card in.
I helped the process of getting this card created, so for all okay. I know, so a couple notes on the tribes. I would watch it a little bit and try to see how you can play into existing stuff. I don't think this does a lot of additional like development. We try to develop tribes when we can. Besides this, I think this is a neat effect. Like very early on when I was developing cards, I remember I had misread a magic card called like Star of Extinction, and I got so upset because it said like deal 20 damage to all creatures. I thought it set would say and players, and it didn't. And so I just spent so long just fuming, and I just wanted a card that just like blew up everything, and you had to find a way to keep yourself from being blown up with it. This does that thematically. The problem is it takes too long and it's too slow. And so I don't know if people are going to vote this in, but I want to believe this card is saveable. So I wanted to maybe have a talk with the panelists about this. Grief, what do you think of this card?
Well, turn 3 or turn 2, depending on if you have actually access to a tune or Barnacle Brothers. Or any kind of coin shenanigans. You can drop this, and yeah, it's technically a must remove for 5 turns, or your opponent can ignore it for most part of the turns, and then it should be removed, because we cannot really accelerate Awakening as of yet, if I remember correctly. So yeah, this is basically a 3 mana do nothing, and be kind of a blocker, whatever. Besides that, cool effect, just way too slow.
Mm-hmm. So at Awaken 3, could this work?
The sooner this happens, the more the question stays like, yeah, what is the game plan? Like, okay, turn 5, kill my opponent because I get him sub 10. Or already on a lethal board where 10 damage more reach, whatever. Or am I doing some self-burn stuff? Is this a creatureless, is this a unitless control deck which just blows up the board and gets more burn damage? Whatever, this is a very versatile in what it can be used. And the problem is the lower the Awakening, the more the point of this card becomes, the more the question of the card becomes like, okay, is this too much?
Yeah. I do agree that there's sort of just a hard to balance type thing here, but I just really, really like this as an object rather than creating two new tribes. I want to believe that this could like work out, but I think the only dial you can really turn is at Awaken. without kind of ruining the point of the card. And I guess the numbers. Kuliak, what do you think?
In its current state, this is kind of a card that I just don't see what deck it would fit into. Like, in a hypothetical scenario where this is actually, like, just doesn't get removed, right? Hypothetical, here. This is probably too slow for any burn aggro deck, because if you play this on 3 mana, getting this effect by turn 8, it's pretty late. And control doesn't want to take 10 damage to face either.
Yeah.
Which is very awkward. I feel like the best bet for salvaging this design is just a downscale across the board. Less damage, lower awaken. The mana cost stats maybe can stay. It's kind of hard to say because it is a 3 mana 0/5, which is in the range where this is where hard removals kick in.
Mm-hmm.
A specific target card removals like Defenestrate, Horrific Hatching. It can be silenced for 2 mana with something like Lingering Wire or Unthink. Best bet, probably make it like a 2 mana 0/3, awaken 3, deal 5 damage. Something along those lines.
Yeah, so this needs to be sped up significantly before it's going to really have a chance to do what it needs to do. But I do really like the concept, and I think we all agreed that we really like the concept. Bellus Divination is a 2-drop strength action from Lux. Withdraw strength action. If you play it this turn, draw another one. So a couple notes on this thing. First of all, I absolutely love this art. It's one of my favorite Spike Bird pieces of all time. It reminds me more so than his normal stuff of a particular like game or card game that I just can't place. Like, I feel like this belongs in another game I played before, which is kind of weirding me out. But anyway, style-wise, very, very cool. Effect-wise, very, very interesting. So it draws an action in a particular affinity that could be this, bear in mind. And then you have a chance to draw another one, so you can get two cards out of this. I would love to see a lot more effects like this in the game. Even though I normally don't like specific affinity references, I think this thing does it right. Wiak, what do you think of this?
In standard, I right now do not see any use for this card. Like, I cannot think of a deck that would want to run this. In Legacy, though, this actually enables a very quirky brew of action spam in KM, where this draws you a Blood Letter, and then a Blood Letter, and then a Blood Letter, and then a Glorious Vault, or something along those lines, while you probably have a Mana Infestation active, generating you a lot of mana and doing a lot of burn damage, which is very fun. The real, like, kind of worst part about this card is that it does say strength action.
Yeah.
I understand why this restriction is there. If it was any sort of action, it would probably be pretty nutty in mind. But that sounds like not even really, because actually I just now realized this doesn't repeat itself.
Yeah, it can only get you up to 2.
Oh, wow. Okay, never mind. This card is a lot less fun than I thought it was. Okay, never mind. This card is just shit. Never mind. It's just bad. There are way easier ways to get a 2 mana draw to. That's way too clunky. Okay, never mind. I thought this effect was interesting.
Grief, what do you think?
The effect is interesting. Just make it loop, and then it's actually a good card.
Mm-hmm. Grief, what do you think of this?
It's certainly fine. The kind of deck that it wants to be played in, it's currently not really existent. It's more or less like the Strength Storm, but I can see at least the tools getting there. Considering the fact that you can at least target tutor specific actions in your deck. So it remains to be seen what more is in store for that specific kind of playstyle, especially when it comes to strength actions, which when it comes to affinities, have at least more freedom in what they're doing, because most of the minecarts boil down to bounce, counter, draw, gain mana.
Mm.
And at least in terms of strength, it can actually be many other things, like promoters, like multiple copies of the divination card, like Bloodletter already mentioned. So, yeah, I'm kind of open for what can be done with it in the future, depending on what more cards we're getting for strength in terms of actions.
Okay.
I want to say though, just I feel like even if like we're not making this loop, this should at least cost one mana. Still, I don't know. Like one mana draw card with upside is a bit scary, but
I can see it. I wanna
say it's hard enough to enable where it would be fine, maybe.
Okay, the Taffy Titan is a 4-drop neutral 2/5 sweet Spectre Golem from Zucros with Ambush and Summon Creep, one of each, Candy and Vigilant. The Candy is, for those of you who don't remember, who just haven't seen them in a while, because they've been updated since I think we've really like actually looked at, or like actually said what they did out loud on the show. Blue Taffy is a 1-drop, give a unit plus 2 attack. Life Crunch is a 1-drop, give a unit life bond, and Mint Berry is a 1-drop, give a unit regenerate. So I really, really like this because this reminds me of shenanigans with like keyword counters in Magic. You can, which we're seeing more of now. So you get this big unit. It's a big unit, but it's like benefits are like split up over multiple cards, and you can reassign those benefits as you do. And I mean, it's couched in this bigger existing candy archetype, but I just thought it was a really, really neat way to go about it. You have a nice, strong, sturdy defensive unit that gives you like plus 3 in CA, and you can drop all these neat little buffs. Wuyak, what do you think of this?
You run this in candy, and that's about it. I don't say use it for this outside of dedicated candy decks. It's very weird for this card to have both ambush and vigilant.
Yes.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense.
Like, at that point, just cut the ambush. The vigilant is literally better ambush. Why have this redundancy in effects?
The thing is, like, this card doesn't even benefit from Vigilant. Let's just keep it Ambush. Like, what the fuck?
I mean, yeah. Hear me out. Okay, hear me out, right? Vigilant is stronger than Ambush because of the face. It cannot be defaced, which is a very... Like, the face is a very prominent card in the metagame.
Yeah, because technically, player-made keywords are not keywords.
I know. The thing is, Vujic, counterpoint. To this day, people kind of plaster Vigilant on cards that actually don't really need Vigilant, which is why the discussion just came up again, why we actually power creep Ambush and Agile with Vigilant. I personally don't have anything against it, but... these kinds of cards just make this argument a little bit stronger, considering the fact that this is mindlessly put Vigilant on a card that has Ambush.
Yeah, no,
I agree that like it feels weird. Like I can see a reason for this to have Vigilant, especially with Blue Taffy being an attack buff candy. But yeah, I personally I would just cut the Vigilant, leave the Ambush there, maybe add another keyword to spice it up.
I can see that.
I mean, we can actually cut the Vigilant and reduce the cost. At that point, it actually is a better enabler for the candy decks and candy action spam decks.
It feels... I do agree with you on that, but it, as far as the actual flavor, it feels like less of a Titan at 3. I don't feel Titan.
It's not a Titan. Funny enough, it is not a Titan.
That is also funny.
In the trials.
It's not even a giant. It's just a sweet Spectre Golem.
Mm-hmm. It's just a Golem, exactly.
Grief, do you have any more comments on this?
I think I'm just cut Vigilant and cut down the cost by one or two. Like,
with adjusted stats, of course.
Adjusted stats, accordingly, of course.
Moving right along, Familiarize is a one-drop mind action from nowhere in particular, with transform the next action played this turn into a random same cost unit. I'm going to actually start with don't likes about this card, because I really do like this card, but my don't likes are like nail-bitingly annoying. Gokun really, really likes the word transform, but this doesn't do transform in the same sense that every other card that does transform does. And so that makes it really potentially like a clunky use of the word. And I feel like that, like, this just needs better wording. Like, we need to use words in a fashion that's consistent, clear, and understandable. And I don't like, I mean, I understand that it works like flavorfully, but like mechanically, we need to have the rules and the uses of our words semantically match up. Now, I've always really liked the art here and the name that he chose with it, because for those of you who don't know, Deface was a card that was made entirely to be a pun. And so this being where it seems like the name of the card was entirely like a top-down built around the pun, I totally dig that. Besides the wording, I really, really like this. I think it's interesting, but I don't know how it would really see play. Grief, what do you think of this?
It's a quirky little design. By the way, it counters the card. So
yeah.
That's something to put out. So know if you're playing your own action afterwards, because yeah, this is until end of turn, it counters your own actions. It turns your own actions into random units, which is quirky and stuff like that, and probably only something that you would probably do in a non-native deck. Otherwise, this is just cute. It's a one-turn blank card in more unit-heavy decks where you say, okay, cool. The next action that my opponent would use against my board is now a unit. Everything else? Yeah, not really. I think it's a little bit underestimated, but since it's one mana, it kind of fits the bill. If it's cheaper, it would be a little bit too strong.
Yeah. So yeah, I think this needs to use the replace wording, because that's closer to what replace does. Transform implies it turns into the other side of the card. If the card doesn't have an other token mode. Wuyek, what do you think of this? Are you still with us?
Oh, whoops, sorry. I mean, in my opinion, it should just state what the card does. It doesn't pose that. I think both transform and replace bring up two questions. One, is the card countered? And two, is the unit played?
Yeah.
And both of which, like currently, without looking at the blocking, I would not be able to give you an answer for, which I think is kind of a problem. So this should just straight up say
what it does.
Counter the next action played and create and play, or create and play. I don't remember which one it is. I don't remember.
It would be create and play.
Well, I don't remember if this plays is the thing.
I think that's the implication, as it does play.
But it doesn't matter. Point is that just make this card say what it actually does. It's probably an uncommon, then whatever, that's fine.
Yeah.
From a balance perspective, I agree. It's a very cute design. It seems pretty bad, though. Just, it's very easily counterplayable. And, like, I would like this a lot more if it was actually a floating counter. If this was a floating counter, it would be a lot better, because eventually this would transform something.
Yeah.
But if your opponent just being able to completely ignore this, and this actually costing you a card, I just don't think right now it's worth running in a deck, unless there's a very specific combo deck that you're trying to target.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. So it has potential as like a sideboard type thing, but it's not floating and it kind of needs to be. Okay. The Petrified Roar is a zero drop neutral artifact from nowhere in particular, with give cards in your hand unplayable until end of turn and gain 3 mana. I think this is cute. I like this idea of very specifically, this reminds me of and was almost certainly inspired by the Lion's Eye Diamond type idea from Magic, where Lion's Eye is actually discard your whole hand for 3 mana, right? Or 3 generic, right, Grief?
Exactly.
This is a very similar kind of thing, but different.
Yeah.
As is, there's stuff you can synergize this with. I don't know the specifics. I mean, in single player, my first thought that comes to mind, because it was the first card I ever got in the game was Flips. there's probably a lot more things you can do with this that are a lot more degenerate, and if we're going to talk about that, we got to turn over to our resident legacy expert, Grief.
To be honest, I absolutely hate this card.
Why?
I'm a vintage player.
Yeah.
I love my Lion's Eye Diamonds. I love killing my opponent turn 1-2. I love Underworld Breach combos that take 20 minutes to kill an entire CEDH table with Lion's Eye Diamond. I don't like this card because it tries so hard to be Lion's Eye Diamond and falls into a very, very, very weird niche that Lion's Eye Diamond actually occupies in its space where it is played. It can only be one of two things. Besides being a bad card that you should put out of your deck, a degenerate combo starter or an extender. And if Petrified Roar doesn't do anything of these two things in your deck, put it out of your deck or build a new deck, because this card will do nothing more besides for created cards or drawn cards to enable more mana, which you can use as an extender or get rid of your hand or whatever and bullshit. This is a card that will never see play except if it breaks shit. And when it breaks it very hard.
Yeah, the only good if it's broken family of cards, basically. Okay. Well, yeah, any thoughts on this?
To be fair, Grief, there is a fair way to use this card. And that is with actives, specifically paid actives, which is actually what the card was designed for. The problem with that is that then we have to look at the pool of paid actives and how many of them are actually worth ramping into. And off the top of my head, I guess there are two different uses. One, this is actually pretty competent if you run Madonna. Giving your Madonna to Rai 6 mana for just a card is very good. Two, you can, and this I do not recommend, you can use it with Avatar of the Eternal to try to go into Neptet. But that's just too interactable. I don't think it's worth it. If anything, mainly I'm looking at Madonna here as an option. If you can gain 3 mana and then like still do something for the turn, like drawing cards and like just get a new hand or something. It's just if you can negate the downside, yeah, just a good combo extender.
The other fair use for this, I've actually been playing around with, I think the username is Alicus. They're one of the newer players that have been around the Discord. Threw out this idea of a Eureka combo deck that does run a 3 of Twilight Library. This does let you do Twilight Libraries, reduce the cards cost of all cards in your hand by 1. Without having to basically skip your turn by paying 4 mana. So on turn 4, when is the first time you'd be able to do that normally, you can actually do a 3-drop, then Petrified Roar, and then reduce the cost of everything in your hand by 1, which I think is kind of nice. But yeah, I do agree that the uses are certainly few and far between, and most use cases I could think of this one are probably going to be broken as heck. And it's only sitting at 1, so perhaps people agree, or they just think this card's just bad?
I will say, just to comment on your use case, I actually do see that I did forget about the use case of Twilight Library. That's actually very valid. That actually makes it more realistic for a deck to just run this with Avatar and Library and just use it for the paid actives. Honestly, that's not too unrealistic. Library is the type of card that your opponent generally will not want to remove since the free mana 0/6. It basically will eat their hard removal. That being said, why would you ever run Twilight Library in a Eureka deck? Even in standard, like, that's just adds.
I'm running it in clunk. XP where the deck need, because there's not a lot of stuff that works really well with you. Well, you've actually done a better build of the Eureka thing since, but
I mean, it's a legacy deck, but
yeah, there was somebody, Eureka. Somebody was trying something a little closer to standard that used it as just a the deck needs to have a lot of like backups and being able to drop a bunch of Dunewalkers on one turn to secure the win. Is pretty useful for it.
I mean, the way I see it is just that's Eureka used wrong, because Eureka, in my opinion, isn't a deck. It isn't like, there is no Eureka Turbo. It's an engine that you can just put in a control deck. And it's but that's getting like sidetracked.
Yeah, and the other build I was looking at was something that was a little more, it had the Eureka combo as one thing it could do with it, and then it was also running like Dunewalkers as backup. And that particular combination of thing where it had a couple different ways to win, Twilight Library did help in a couple runs, but the deck still needs a lot of polishing. And it was just Alakis's build and deck list, if anyone wants to check it out. Cocoon City Cadet is a 2-drop Spirit 0/3 Insect Gunslinger from Karapak. With Duelist, can't attack. When a unit leaves your graveyard, this gets +1 attack and active. Banish a card in a graveyard. You gain 2 HP. This card made me, first of all, like, I want to start with the flavor on this. Like, I love the art. I love the flavor text and all that. The card confuses me. It just seems like it's a little, I mean, I get it. Okay, Duelist can't attack. You got to get stuff out of your graveyard, but it also has this active to fuel it. But honestly, you're running this and stuff where you probably have something else doing that, because that doing that active is way too slow. But maybe I'm wrong about everything. And so I wanted to have somebody else comment on it, maybe see if I'm missing something. Grief, what do you think of this?
To be honest, you're basically not using the active to pump this dude. This is just an off effect due to the passive ability or the passive trigger from a wolf, where using the active to gain 2 life will also accidentally buff this dude by 1 attack, which is just a neat synergy on the card. But for the most part, when you're hunting for the buff this out of the wazoo to have a very good a 2-drop duelist that duels away any kind of unit. Self-banish stuff or interactions that banish cards from your graveyard for cost, etc. are very good for synergies with this card. So moving forward, this will be probably a card that you can drop in Marie and go from there to have a more control-esque unit that interacts in a way where you can actually synergize with what you want to banish, what you want to reuse for your summons, whatever, while also keeping the 2 HP up or having life gain synergies. This is just a very cute card that does a lot of things well enough.
Yeah, I do see that he's versatile. It's just, I guess I don't see the deck. I don't know the deck he goes in, so I don't see the play pattern yet. Well, Yek, what do you think of this?
I mean, the way I see it can go into 3 different decks, actually. One, probably not that well, but it can be played in Insects, because Insects have access to Hawkins' Burden, they have access to Fox, Silver Rush, and if you're running this, you're probably running some other recursion package. It's not that hard to get one going. With stuff like Lesser Ray's Dead in standard. Other than that, because a 0/3 body is just very good, and it's not super difficult to pump this up. And of course, as Grief mentioned, Marie, where this is very good for fucking out your active. until Marie gets reworked, and then that entire plan comes out the window.
Yeah.
What's the rework on Marie?
Well, her button isn't. That's all you need to know. But the way I see it, also the active here is it's not a thing that you'll be pressing unless either A, you have a card in your graveyard that you want to be banished, like Bonefetcher, which when it leaves your graveyard, it draws you a card.
Yeah.
Or B, your opponent has a thing in the graveyard that you don't want them to have there, like a second Sunrise, because this can banish your opponent's cards. So the way I see it is it's kind of just a jack of all trades, master of none. It's a good unit that does a lot of things, not of them super well, but well enough.
Okay. And that's kind of what I was thinking this design was, but I didn't really know enough about the meta there. Okay. Feliz Adept Guard is a 3-drop spirit, 2/3 undeadlies from Mirage with Vigilance and Entrance Exhaust unit. I actually really just thought like the text box is cute, that it's it's a card that it enters, exhausts something, and then readies itself before combat. Just neat. I'm glad we have that text on a card somewhere. We don't do a lot with like just single unit, just exhausts. Like this is a big thing in certain sets in Magic where you have exhausting or caring about things being exhausted, and we just don't have a whole lot of that. So I thought that was really cute.
We do a lot of overload.
Yeah, like I don't see so much of that here, and so I thought that was really interesting. And I did see some other stuff from Korn that seemed to be in this vein of caring about either actives or I think Vigilant with the Lizabo. I think it's a fun direction. The art has also been really interesting, so I'm glad Korn's doing this. Booyak, what do you think of this?
So I'm kind of in a weird boat with this design because I like it. Anyway, I like the effect. I like the entrance effect. I find the combination of this entrance effect with a vigilant unit to be kind of awkward. And more importantly, it is very weird for this card to be a Lizafem, in my opinion.
I think the text box is really cute. I don't know about it being a Lizafem, but I think the box is really cute.
That second effect is very unprecedented for the archetype. I honestly think that's maybe one of the reasons why it's not doing super well. Because exhausting is just not something that deck does.
Wuyak, I just established that exhausting is not something like anything in our card based.
Yes, but what I mean.
Spider okay, that yeah, does I it, understand. I think that's it.
Listen, I understand. But what I'm saying is some random undead doing it, I would get. Some random elemental doing it, I would get. It's specifically that Lizafep have like these few mechanical identities, like they have a few mechanical themes, and exhausting is very just out of left field. It's very random for them to do.
I don't know. I'm gonna have faith
in
Korn. It
feels weird to me.
But
I'm excited. I like the card. Don't know about the combination of this entrance and this vigilant though. It feels very awkward to me.
Grief, what do you think of this?
I think it's a very cool design. The problem is more like that probably people download it because of the aforementioned, Vigilant is everywhere. Let's download all cards that have Vigilant on them.
I would buy that more than Wuyak's explanation.
Part of it, yeah. Which, as I said, I don't really agree with that tangent. I understand when it comes to cards that have Vigilant on them for no apparent reason. I'm very much fine with it here. Yes, this could have been Agile, this could have been Ambush, this could have been a combination of the two. Wouldn't be so clean. And quite honestly, I do like a cleaner transition to combat mechanics, which is why Vigilant is a very common, welcome change to our combat dynamics in the game. And I kind of agree why it works on this card, because if I remember correctly, exhausting does neutralize ambush and
yes,
agile, but not vigilant. So a card that actually on entrance, so it works with either reanimation or put into play or recruiter effects, which is very cool to have a Lazabu that does that. To also have the ready whatever you want to be an aggressive or a defensive unit for either play styles, for the more controllish spirit Lazabu or the more face as the place red Lazabu, this is just fitting.
Yeah.
Outside of that, I don't really have an issue with the card. I don't really understand why it's doing so bad besides the overreaction of, oh yeah, Vigilant is everywhere, we don't need it.
Yeah. Okie dokie then. Sunny Songbird is a 2-drop neutral 1/2 bird bard from Concierta with flying and summon create Birdhouse Soul. Birdhouse Soul is a 1-drop song with draw a card, then draw a card for every 2 songs in your graveyard. I like this just because it's cute. Like, it's just so cute. The art is cute. The art on the token is cute. Just the name is cute. Like, this thing is just really adorable and I think really, really nice and fitting for Concierge in particular. And it does synergy with the song stuff. I've been waiting for a song to speak to me well enough for me to try this archetype because I've actually tried similar things in designs like that before that did not work. I'm just kind of, I don't know, I'm waiting for like the right one to come along, and this one almost does it for me. This one almost makes you want to pick up the deck. Grief, what do you think of this?
I love songs. This probably has to do with the fact that I'm trying to build main deck songs. Not just creative ones. And I absolutely adore this card. Design-wise, it's just a solid enough unit. It comes with an extra action. It's neutral, so you can play it technically everywhere. Bards benefit greatly from it. Summon re-triggers are very good on it because you just get a 1-cost neutral card draw. And for every more copies of songs or whatever, if we ever get main deck songs, then holy hell, this is becoming a staple. And every other song bard becomes very, very, very explosive and good. But Birdhouse Soul is such a good card.
Yeah. I think this is going to mean that my attempt to get my own little birdie with a draw effect on it is probably not going to work out.
I upvoted the card.
Okay.
Because such, as I said, you cannot fault the card for the art. Design is cute as well as the art.
Yeah, so this is definitely the bigger, more upgraded version for if you're running a bard deck, a song deck, run this. But there is, I hear, another really great option for the one or two of us who are playing around with Doomsday Chickens. Called Chicken a la Carte.
Oh my god, Doomsday Chickens.
Chickens, I've been playing around with it. It got hit bad by the nerf because it needs to kill you. Because you're running a bunch of chickens. The deck absolutely needs to kill you right then and there. And so the nerf, which made it harder for it to kill you, hit the deck really bad. But I think with the right pieces in it, it can still go back together. So we'll see. Wujek, what do you think of this?
I mean, I would just say straight up, the right pieces for that deck that you're mentioning are you just ditch Doomsday and put in an actual good self-suck package that wins you a game.
No, the point is you're supposed to be running Doomsday. Doomsday was that card until a nerf.
Anyways.
I'm gonna be honest,
I just picked it because, yeah, it's just really cute.
It is.
Cute art, cute effect, very cute flavor text.
Wholesome energy.
It's just very positive energy, very positive aura. My only worry is that I'm a little bit worried that the bards as a tribe have so much CA generation with, like, every single, like, song bard making you a card and then, like, some bard's giving you a card when you play a bard or something like that. Where I'm a little bit worried the Birdhouse Soul effect may not be as useful as you'd want it to be.
Yeah.
I mean, even then, at worst, it's another song in the graveyard.
Yeah. So yeah,
and keep another song in the graveyard is pretty important when you have In Bliss, which I still am. That card is so naughty.
It's in the game. At 17 votes, this card's basically in the game, so let's move on. Yeah. Enjoy this card. It's in the game, guys. No. Crescenda Crashalot is a 3-drop mind 1/3 Lisabeau Bard from Concierto with can't block, agile, and summon. This gets +1 attack for each song in your graveyard. Return a song from your graveyard to your hand. So I really like, I do love this, the attitude, the whole thing where this is a cover artist. So it doesn't create her own song. It just gets something back. The name just is a little goofy. I feel like we could have searched a little harder for like a pun there, but maybe I'm just missing the existing pun. But yeah, overall, I really think this is neat. Of course, it's a camp lock and agile, so this thing is basically trying to be a lightning ball that recurs a song, which is a great combination. Really, really great, really, really neat mechanical combination. I noticed you were doing a lot of picking for your realm. Curious. No, just kidding. I do that every single time somebody makes a card for my realm. Wuyak, what do you think of that?
I just want to say first, Kamatuni is saying that the bird is basically, and keep in mind, I have once had a card on the subreddit with 19 upvotes and it didn't get in.
Yeah, but there's a difference when it's the only card at 17 upvotes.
Oh, yeah, it was. No, it was the only card at night at above 10, actually, and it didn't get in. Yeah, that was Weird Science, which is pretty fitting for a card with that name to have that outcome. But yeah, so this card I picked because I think it's kind of a victim of Tech Scratch, in a way. As there is a way to make this card a lot better and a lot less clunky in its own archetype, but it just slightly makes it over the uncommon. And that is, I think instead of returning a song, it should create a copy of a song in your hand. Because having a card in an archetype that cares about having as many songs in the graveyard as possible, remove one of them is a bit iffy, in my opinion.
I think it's that's fair. I really think you need to have a lot of these effects worded like this to keep this kind of thing in check.
Well, yeah, it's a cover artist, so she should make a cover, not just take the old record from the dumpster bin and sell it as her own.
Not with cover artists.
Some people would argue that's exactly what cover artists do.
Yeah, I will say though, this makes me want to experiment with the Lisabeau package in a Sunrise deck because we've had two other Lisabeau song bards before, but they just weren't enough. And this being just a very solid beat stick that probably recurs a 2-Clonabard, which, by the way, if this gets hit by 2-Clonabard, you just get to replay her.
Mm.
It's just very cute and very fun. And I'm really interested if this is something that could even be pursued. I don't think it can be. I think it would be at best like a casual cute deck for funsies. But I mean, I'm playing Second Sunrise in the Year of the Lord 2022. That card is like way past its time.
I just think if this thing had, I just think if like 10 more minutes was put into the name, or 5 more minutes was put into the name, I just think this would be such a better card. I don't know why it bugs me that much, but I'm the kind of guy who just gets bugged about weird things. Oh, I feel like there was a good joke there, and I just don't know what that joke is. Oh. Right when we were about to switch to Grief, you know what Grief does? He goes and just leaves us. He just ditches us right there with him and his sound foam.
So, yeah, I love this card. To be honest, bards in particular and the song archetype just resonates very resonates a lot with me. Just to the point where I really, 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 really want to build something with it that plays a lot of key songs. Sure, she doesn't copy, but some songs you really want to replay with, and you not being not having to rely on the fact that you have to copy or replay the part that creates a specific song you want to utilize with Crashalot is basically the best thing that you can find. By the way, it's fine that she turned out to be a cover artist, because for the longest time I said, okay, cool, now make this a token and a card that creates like 11 tokens of it, because this is just a number 9 of a Korean boy band pop idol group where every freaking member looks the freaking same, does some weird dance poses. By the way, I'm probably getting canceled by the J and K-pop community right now.
Just banish any number of cards in your hand and replace them with copies of this thing.
Exactly. But yeah, this is just a very cool design, and I love it. It's simple enough. Let's for the text or for the mechanics I go into it, it's simple enough. It's a beat stick that's agile, that can't block. But for the deck, it is utilized, and it's just such a neat little versatile tool, besides being, as you said, a lightning bolt on a stick.
Yeah. I really think
have like a final note, because I just want to say, when it comes to songs as an archetype, they right now, like, let's hypothetically say both Discard and Sunny get in, right?
Mm-hmm.
I honestly think there's a very cool engine there.
Yeah.
Like, there's a very cool tempo engine. But I really agree with you, Stranger, here, that there's just something missing. That, like, that little something that actually gives me a reason to build the deck and play with it. And actually, like, experiment with refinement. That kind of
stuff
is not there quite yet.
Yeah. And I feel it's close. And so I want to upvote this stuff. Like, I want to upvote this stuff. I want to get this into the game. Then I want someone to say, here's a brew I've been playing around with, and then play around with it in a single player.
I mean, yeah. To me, it feels like, so far, the song cards that have been getting in, all of them, pretty good. Even some of the worst ones, like Affect Twin, is kind of just mediocre, but it's still an okay card. It's just that we have this pack filler, in quotation mark, of the archetype, but there's the only, like, really big payoff is Inbliss. And don't get me wrong, Inbliss is insanely strong, but I think the archetype needs that one more spark.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to halt the share. So, it's weird, because I had a lot of problems making picks for this week. Then when I actually looked at the picture of the week, I'm like, this is a good week, it's just it only had about 10 cards in it. It had exactly enough to, like, to get into the game. But there's nothing wrong with any of the cards. So we'll see how things go. So fun stuff. Thank you very much, Grief, for joining me today.
You're welcome. It's always nice to be here.
And thank you very much, Wujek, as well. Always great to have you on the show.
No problem.
We haven't seen Spike in a minute. Hey, Spike, reach out to me in a DM and let me know what your work schedule is. I know I shouldn't be doing that, like, on my podcast, but I'm just going to do that way, because I keep forgetting to invite people onto the show who I want to have on the show. So now I'm obligated to do it, because it's in the episode.
I think he's generally asleep around the time you record.
I see. So anyways, like, comment, and subscribe. Remind me why I'm doing this, and keep on playing Collective. Keep on voting on cards. Bye.
See you.
Bye.